Today is our last lesson for the lunar year, and actually it's Chinese New Year. Then, very nicely, we begin with a new volume. It's volume 44. So today we'll be studying two suttas of the same name, and the title is Pariyavasa Sutta, number 1 and number 2. Now, very often there are sets of suttas like this. Sometimes you have even half a dozen, but usually one or two. So, Pariya means the noble ones. Here refers to the saints of the path, beginning with the streamers upwards. However, in this title, the wasa part, wasa means abiding, it means way of life, even nature, the person if you like, but more to do with practice. Okay? What do the saints, what do the arahats especially practice, what do they do? So Aryavasa we can explain as the lifestyle, the arahat if you like. So you got Sutta 1, Sutta 2. The Sutta 1 is very short, it just gives you only the list of teachings without any explanation. And then Sutta 2 gives you the explanation of each of the 10 items or 10 aspects of the practice of the arahat. So we have this very common kind of arrangement where you have a very short sutta which just gives you the items, and then second one, same thing, the items are repeated, and then there is the explanation. And this is very well in keeping with the oral tradition of the Buddha's time, of early Buddhism, where what normally people would do is maybe the gathering will recite Sutta 1, they will recite the teachings, and after that the teacher will explain one by one the meaning of those of each of the items. Right? So Aryavasa Sutta 1, Pali, in Pali is Pathama Aryavasa Sutta. It is located, or the reference is A10.19. So since it's the same as Sutta 2, we'll go straight into Sutta 2. Aryavasa Sutta 2 is on page 183. Dutiya Aryavasa Sutta. I did put the Pali name this time. I just remember at the Pali Dutiya. Okay? A10.20. So you notice here A10. Once you see the number, the very first number following A, that refers to the chapter. The chapter of 10 is there's 10 important topics, so 10 important things there. Sutta 20. And then there's the theme. I'm looking at the top right hand corner of page 183. Then there's the theme, the 10 qualities of an arahat defined. Okay? Now this is quite a long sutta, so I'll go straight into the sutta and explain to you. This translation starts on page 191. Okay. As before, let me remind you always either remember the sutta name or the sutta reference. That way, whatever you are talking about is more authentic. Okay? Otherwise, it's very difficult when you ask something, someone says, oh, this is probably what the Buddha said, I'm not very sure. So you find you can't use such kind of quotation. So it's good to remember exactly where you got it from, the Pali word, okay, and the reference. So we do have this kind of a record where we can authenticate all these teachings, and this is very important. And this is the time in our local Buddhist history where people are becoming more serious about all these early texts, because we want to know the actual teaching, okay? The Pali texts, what are those texts like? And we still have those records, so it's very good that we pay some attention to it. The sutta starts. Notice there's no introduction, no Ewang Me Sutang, because this is very common in the Anguttara. Anguttara, even Samyutta, you find many of the suttas do not have Evamme Suttam. They do not start with the introduction, thus I heard, because they are recited in a long kind of collection, and the Evamme Suttam is only mentioned right at the start of the chapter. So this is already 10.20, this is Sutta 20. So you have to go to Sutta 1. In 10.1, you will find Evamme Suttam. Okay, so this is how they memorize the teachings. Right? So the suttas go straight into the location. Section 1 says, at one time the Blessed One was dwelling amongst the Kurus near the market town of the Kurus called Kamasadama. Okay, the Kurus are a very intelligent group of people. In fact, it's to them that the Buddha taught the Satipatthana Sutta. Okay, so he gave many of those heavy teachings to this community of people. And here's one more. There the Blessed One addressed the monks, bhikshus. Vipante, the monks replied. Okay, you notice this, in fact, this part is a bracket here. I just add in to complete the short form. Bhikshus, bhikshu actually is Sanskrit, it's also English. I have a tendency to use what is already available in English, what is accepted in the literary world. You can find the word bhikshu in the Oxford English Dictionary, in the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, so bhikshu means monk. And the Blessed One said this. So whenever you see this line, the Blessed One said this, this is an oral tradition quote, it means the teaching is going to start. Right? Bhikshus, there are these 10 abidings in which the noble ones abided or are abiding or will abide. What are the 10? Okay, here what the Buddha basically is saying, these 10 things are what an arahat would normally do, whether in the past or in the future or right now. Okay, so we start with the thesis. All right, so this first part is the 10 points, the summary. What are the 10? Here, bhikshus, a monk is one who has abandoned the five factors, is accomplished in the six limbs, is guarded in the one, has four mental supports, has put aside personal truths, has completely given up seeking, with untroubling thoughts, or you can translate thoughts as intentions also, whose bodily activity is stilled or calm, tranquilized, who is mentally well liberated, who is well liberated by wisdom. Now, 9 and 10, they go together as a pair, as we will soon see. So these are the 10 things, almost in code. Here again, we're talking about oral tradition. All right, so the first line says, he has abandoned 5 factors. All right, so we do, and this already struck curiosity among some of you. I'm sure you say, okay, what are the 5? Right? So the audience, of course, will be very curious. And when you look at 1 to 10 here, yes, you are right if you guess this is probably a progression, right? So they come in sets, more or less a kind of, there are some basic patterns we can use. The most common pattern in this kind of text would be the 3 trainings. The 3 trainings, sikkhataya, sikkha training. In other words, training in moral virtue, okay, sila sikkha, and then training in mental concentration, samadhi sikkha. And then you have panyasika, training in wisdom. Okay, so these are the 3 trainings. Sometimes, well, often enough, we have this term called adhisika, A-D-H-I, adhisika. Very similar to abhi, but this is adhi. Yeah? It means higher, both means higher. So this refers to the higher training. Very often when this training is applied to the monks, they are said to be higher training. For example, Adi Sila Sikha, the higher training in moral virtue. So this would mean it involves celibacy, the rules of the monks and so on. And then Adi Samadhi Sikha refers to meditation leading to jhanas. And then you've got Adi Panya Sikha, is the kind of wisdom that you get leads to the path, in other words, becoming at least stream winning. And then there are two more. The last two, there's number 9 and 10. Okay? So I'll talk about this when we come to the last part. So here, in other words, the training is called higher training. So the kind of practice we do, you might say, as unawakened practitioners, is simply called the three trainings, which are best to give them 5 precepts. We do some mindfulness practice, meditation, and of course we try to learn some suttas. So we need to take one more step, that is to put into effect all these things we have learned, that is to aspire to attain stream winning in this life. In other words, the goal of all this training is to reach the destination, right? I mean, you don't just go on practicing, you know? I mean, you have a goal in Buddhist training. So it's good to understand what it means to aspire to stream winning. The simple meaning is we want to make sure we do not fall below the human realm, because if you are reborn below the human realm in the next life, it will be very difficult to get out of it. Be very difficult to practice the Dharma. So the idea of the precepts, the 5 precepts even, is the baseline below which we should not fall. The precepts are there to keep this quality control, to make sure we do not fall below the human line. We remain at least human and as happy humans, because in order to practice the precepts well, you need metta, you need loving kindness. You feel happy, you feel full of loving kindness, it's easier to keep the precepts. If you are happy, you're full of loving kindness, you don't feel like killing or stealing, committing sexual misconduct and so on. So don't forget all these attending virtues. You don't practice anything in isolation, they're all interconnected. So let's begin number one. What is the 5 mentioned here? So it's very clear, the header is given to you. Okay, in the Sutta Discovery series, we do a lot of extra stuff for you. So you have this subheader. You can see the round brackets 1, overcoming the 5 mental hindrances. You don't find this in the original text. This in the translation is to help us. We can call ourselves a scribal tradition, if you like. Scribal, that means we read things, okay? Whereas the Sutta is an oral tradition. So in the scribal tradition, we use our eyes more, so it's very... It helps a lot to put all these sub-headers, numbering, arranging of, you notice I arrange some of these columns of words, so easier on the eye. The moment you look at it, your eye will naturally follow. It's easier to remember. So in section 3, you have the translation on the right. Sometimes I put the Pali on the right, on the left, I mean. But here the Pali is on the right. I purposely put the Pali here because, you know, as teachers sometimes you forget the Pali words. So there you are, it's right there. And so this is also to help the teacher. If it's not there on the convenient space, it'll be in the footnotes. So these are basic stuff which you know, and you find the Sutta Discovery very helpful if you're teaching Dharma. Okay. And what big shoes are the 5 factors abandoned by the monk? But the word the monk here refers to the Arahat. Here, bhikshus, for the monk, sensual desire has been abandoned, ill will has been abandoned, sloth and torpor has been abandoned, restlessness and remorse has been abandoned. I've changed this to restlessness and guilt, actually, because we have lots of lawyers in this class. One lawyer said actually remorse can be a good thing. I mean, if you feel remorseful, you know, you won't do this bad thing again, you see. That's very true. I suppose if you use remorse, you can see a negative aspect of remorse. The actual negative emotion is guilt. Because you have a lot of guilt, it's difficult to meditate. Guilt is looking back to the past, thinking about things done and undone, that's guilt. Whereas restlessness is something like thinking about the future. So excited what you're going to do, so your mind becomes restless. Okay? So restlessness and guilt has to do with the mind thinking about the past, thinking about the future. And of course, number 5 is doubt. So these are the five mental hindrances. The Arahant has overcome all this, meaning he is able to meditate well. As a rule, the Arahant is able to attain jhana quite easily. To attain non-return arahatut, you have to be able to attain jhanas at least. This is the theoretical understanding. The great arahats are also able to attain the four formless jhanas, which not all arahats attain. So that's, those are the full-fledged arahats, if you like Sariputta Moggallana. So this first part here, the five, overcoming the five mental hindrances, refers indirectly, obliquely, to the ability to attain jhanas. Number two is sense restraint. The sutta says, and how bhikshus is a monk accomplished in the six limbs. So just the word six limbs mentioned to hone the curiosity of the audience. Then the Buddha explains, here bhikshus, a monk seeing a form with the eye, is neither mentally pleased nor displeased. He dwells equanimous, mindful, and clearly comprehensive. Alright? Now you have a list of things here. So I've underlined for you the key words. So you just read the first four lines. You'll find these are four lines, they'll repeat themselves, and then you look at the next one, the ear, and then the nose. So it refers to the six senses, the six sense bases. So this section talks about the arahat being well controlled, very mindful with all his faculties, all the six sense bases, eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind. And this is understandable, because he's a deep meditator, so he's also very mindful. Under normal circumstances, in other words, in an unawakened state, normally we would say be self-restrained first. You are self-restrained, you go for a retreat, your teacher will tell you, be mindful and so on, and then you are able to overcome the five mental hindrances more easily. But here we're talking about the Arahat who's already awakened, he has overcome all the five mental hindrances, so by nature he is self-restrained. Self here refers to the six senses. But look at the first part, because the first part will kind of explain all the rest. This is like a corner of the net. You just put a corner, you got the whole net. So make sure you understand the first four lines. These are very famous lines. In fact, I've written a whole essay by itself to explain this, how to restrain ourselves. It starts with the second line, bottom line, page 191. Seeing a form with the eye. In other words, here's the eye, that's the form, there is seeing. Next line says, he is neither mentally pleased nor displeased. He dwells equanimous, mindful, clearly comprehending. Okay. Here everything is shortcut. There are long suttas, for example, the teaching given to Bahia, where this line explains beautiful detail. So I'm giving you a further explanation, something like what's given in the Bahia teaching. How do we practice this? When you are looking at something, there is just this action of looking. Okay, so in other words, we objectify this action. We take it as an object, we do not subjectify, we don't tell stories about it, we don't link it to some other things. We just take it as it is. Now, this is the, you know, as you study suttas in the Dharma, if you understand other more of the fine arts, you begin to see the basis of all these wonderful teachings, all these wonderful teachings become the basis of the final learning in human civilization. This ability to just see what is seen can be understood as the basis for aesthetics, the philosophy of beauty. So you find the Buddha's teaching has got very profound roots of culture. What am I talking about here? I say. Now, we have seen people there are art galleries in Singapore. I've not been to any of them, but I've been to a few in London, the Tate Gallery and all this portrait gallery. I remember I went to one of them, there was this beautiful painting by this Spanish painter, Velázquez, I think. And this person was sitting there, just looking at the painting for hours, you know, just looking. Because they want to feel the painting. They want to study very carefully how the figures are painted and so on. You know? So, in other words, and same thing with music. When you listen to music, it's a way of listening if you are a musician. And you begin to notice the patterns and the speed, whether it's well played or not. But you can only do this with full attention, complete attention. That is why people do not clap hands in the middle of a movement, say a symphony, or they don't eat kwachi or gaonas in a music hall. They want the complete attention of this beautiful piece being played. It's an experience of beauty. It's not mere entertainment, it is an experience of beauty. They're quite different. So same thing here. What makes the Arahat really happy is able to do this. He just sits quietly and he hears sounds. And to him, wow, this is beautiful, it's like a symphony. Now we need a whole orchestra to hear this, get this effect, you know. But this Arahat says, oh, this is beautiful, you know, doesn't need an orchestra. Now that's the big difference. Because the Arahat is so, his senses are so sensitive, he is so happy. Even as he walks on the floor, he looks at this, he says, wow, look at this floor, it's so clean and shiny. And joy rises in him. We call that simple joy, okay? So, this sense restraint is not a very good word actually. We have the idea of restraint means you can't do this, you can't do that. It's far from that. It means this Arahat's mind is so focused, he's really looking what's in front of him. And that's the artist's way of looking at things. That's the musician's way of looking at things. That's the real good dancer's way of doing things. You are totally focused. Okay? So you can imagine the idea of beauty is behind this description of mindfulness. Number three, clear comprehending, or being mentally well guarded. And how bhikshus is the monk guarded in the one? So here again, kind of a quoted teaching. Here bhikshus, a monk is mentally accomplished in being guarded with mindfulness. In this way, bhikshus, the monk is guarded by the one. Oh, I love this particular passage because it answers one big riddle. And that riddle is given to us in the Satipatthana Sutta. If you are familiar with the Satipatthana Sutta, there is a line there near the beginning. There's a phrase called the one way. Have you heard of that? This is the one way, the only way, right? And this has caused some bit of controversy what it means. Now, in order to interpret that kind of sentence or that kind of phrase, you got to look at the occurrence of that word or that phrase elsewhere. And here you are, you have the occurrence of the one, Eka. So notice, the first line says, and how bhikshus is the monk gathered in the one, just like that, the one. So at once you have a good hint, Eka. And then the other sutta says the one way. There's some link there. Okay, we're not very sure. Do they actually mean the same thing? But we can have an educated guess. And both talk about meditation. So again, a good sign there. In fact, just to cut the long theory short, let me just say, look at the section 6. Here bhikshus, a monk is mentally accomplished in being guarded with mindfulness. The one, to my understanding, means the meditator is focused. Why one? Well, you can say one in the sense the mind is one. The mind is one-pointed. Or you can use similar word. The meditator is single-minded, ekacitta. So the one here refers to the focused mind, samadhi in meditation. Once you have that kind of understanding, when you start reading other passages, it becomes easier. It decodes itself. So we have another mysterious term, which up to today, it's not fully explain. No teacher really knows what it really means. The word is padekaraka.
You can see Eka here.
Padekarata is the name of seven suttas, I think the four or five of them. The problem is, how do we translate this Padekarata? Okay, but the compounds resolve as Bada plus Eka plus Rata. Bada can translate as fortunate, lucky, good. Eka plus one. Now, Rata is a problem here. Rata can mean night. That means Ratri in Sanskrit. Night. Night of meditation. Or it can also mean delighted. Past participle, delighted, or Rata in Sanskrit. So how do we translate this? We can translate one who is fortunate in one night. In terms of meditation, sits down, one night meditation is managed to get deep states. Okay, one night. Or one who delights in the fortunate one who delights in the one. So you can interpret it in different ways. Let me simplify by saying this term, if you understand Eka as samadhi, you can translate something like this wonderful samadhi, the one who delights in this wonderful oneness of mind, this fortunate wonderful mind. Okay. So once you understand that one had to mean samadhi, the puzzle is solved. You see, this is the thing about Pali. You see, in English, in a sense, English, Chinese is even more so. They're very exact in their meanings. If you take Chinese, one word is kind of the meaning you should be fixed. You just write the word right, it means man. Okay? In English also, English words tend to be very fixed in meaning. In a sense that is good, we call that that is the technical exactness, but it creates a problem when you talk about poetry, the arts, and spiritual experience. Because spiritual experience, as you know, go beyond words. Some of how do you describe your joy in meditation? How do you describe awakening? Very hard to find the words. My point is, in Pali, you must understand there are many words. In fact, it is often the rule that a single Pali word is polysemic. Polysemic means have more than one meaning. And what's even more problematic, very often, all the meanings apply. How are you going to translate it into English? Because when you translate it into English, you only get one meaning on it. Alright? I mean, take a simple word like the word Buddha. We can say Buddha is one who understands, the one who has awakened. So two ways of translating it. And the Westerners have translated it as the enlightened one, which is actually, now scholars say, is not really correct. So there you are, you've got to decide which one you want, and how do you put all the meanings in. So these are some issues of translators to struggle with. We use footnotes, we use amplified translation, and so on. So remember, when you read Pali words, very often the Pali word is pregnant. It's got more than one meaning. So, and this also behooves us, reminds us to be a bit open with words. Because some students may say, oh, my teacher says it means this. And one says, no, my teacher says it means that. It's the Quranic. So all of them are right. You know? Because one, this word has got different senses, and you've got to see the context. That helps too. But sometimes the word is such, it has different meanings, because it refers to different aspects of the mind and so on. So do bear this in mind. So we're talking about the one here. Sometimes the one can be seen from many aspects. Number four, the mental supports. And how bhikshus is among mentally supported in four ways. Now, mentally supported, okay? having considered, he reflectively uses one thing. Having considered, he endures another. Having considered, he avoids another. Having considered, he removes another. In this way, Bhikshus, the monk is mentally supported in four ways. Mental support. In other words, how does he maintain mental calm, mental satisfaction, mental joy? This in terms of the monk's practice regarding situations around him, regarding the things he need to use, like the four supports. Okay? So the four mental supports are reflective usage, endurance, avoidance, removal. This is found in the Sabbasava Sutta. Number one, a monk supports his mind, keeps his mind peaceful and calm through reflective usage. This refers to the four supports. When he uses his robes, he says, okay, I'm using this robe purely to cover myself, protect myself from the cold, not to adorn myself, not to show off myself. Basically, to use robes for the spiritual life. Right? So, this is why do we need to clothe ourselves, okay, for a monk like this. So this basically is the idea of living simply, simple life for the monk. Right? Of course, for lay people, we can also refer in this way. Basically, what we're saying is, we eat to live, okay? Right? So in other words, food has an instrumental purpose for us. We're not going to eat and eat and waste the food and there are hungry people around, okay? Something like that. Then number two, endures. Okay, this is in terms of practice. When you want to practice, sometimes when you want to go for meditation retreat, we ask around, say, is this place very nice? Do you have aircon room or not? Water supply, so on and so forth. I mean, it's quite natural to ask such things. But you can't always get an ideal place. Sometimes you go to this meditation place, very nice place, but a lot of mosquitoes. Maybe it's too hot, too cold, right? Or no running water. We have to endure. Now, we're talking about ourselves going to a meditation retreat. Imagine a forest monk living in the forest where they have none of those amenities that we have in the retreat center. And he has to make do with stream water and so on. So, in other words, a monk has to endure a lot of things in the forest. The heat, the cold, the insects. So, he reflects in that ways as well. I become a monk, I'm living a simple life. So, these things happen to me and I have to endure them. So you will never say it's too hot, too cold, too early, too late, and so on. And he will practice. Okay? So we need some kind of endurance. So in a sense, you can say that early Buddhism is a kind of endurance spiritual sport, if you like. I mean, you go for a retreat. Yeah? And then number three, he avoids. Here is with the mind. We'll be able to tell ourselves, okay, there are certain things I got to avoid. Thoughts of desire, things which make me want things I don't need, which is not helpful, not healthy. Right? So we've got to avoid that kind of thoughts. Thoughts that arouse hate, thoughts that are based in delusion. We have to at once clear away, get rid of those thoughts. And the best way is given in method number two. Right, to be mindful, what we mentioned earlier. So this one is avoidance method. So in a sense, these are also, you might say, in a modern way, psychological method. Hmm? And the last one is removal. Removal. Here, we get rid of things which are not helpful to us, especially in our daily life. As a practitioner. Now, by the way, all these are given to you on page 185. We want to look at them in detail. Okay? So, this look at 244, removal refers to you examine your mind, say, oh, I have thoughts of desire, I've got to get rid of that. I have thoughts of hatred, I've got to get rid of that. I have deluded thoughts, I've got to get rid of that. So identifying mental state and then going to your meditation to clear them away. So these are different approaches to maintain your mind, to keep it steady, in other words. Now, in the case of the Arahat, it is number four. So in other words, this happens to him as a natural course of practice. Okay? Whereas in our case of the unawakened person, we got to start with this earlier on. So in the case of the Arahat, he will naturally do all these things. Somebody made a very interesting remark on my Facebook. I was saying that these Arahats, they're very happy, they can easily meditate even after they are awakened. So this person made a slight remark and said, oh, they're already awakened, why do they still need to meditate? You know, I mean, sometimes these remarks can be quite challenging. You know? So I said, well, so this is where it's best to give some kind of analogy. Okay, I said, if a little nestling has grown his feathers and he has got wings, it's full-fledged, its nature is to fly, and it will keep on flying. So once he has wings, it will fly. He can choose not to fly, but can still fly. So it's the nature of the Arahat, because he already mastered meditation and his mind is free from all these negative emotions, the natural thing to do is to meditate. Because when you meditate, you don't have to do with sound, you don't have to do with smells. Because Arahats, they do sense all these things also, but they are more sensitive than we are. Once they go into meditation, they do not have to sense all these things. So they experience joy in that sense. They don't have to process things around them. So in other words, it's their nature to be at peace with themselves. So for that reason, they enjoy meditating. Number five, giving up of personal truths. And how vicious is a monk one who has put aside personal truth? So this Arahat is one who has put aside personal truth. Here, bhikshus, whatever for a monk are worldly personal truth of worldly recluses or Brahmins. And then it's defined, okay? That's to say, the world is eternal, the world is not eternal, or the world is finite, or the world is infinite. Okay, these are speculative views on the nature of the universe. Because today, scientists are more sure on the nature of the universe, but in the Buddhist time, they are less sure. Now, of course, even today, when we say those astrophysicists, astronomers, they are more sure of the universe, but even then, even the experts don't agree, don't all agree. Right? So these are still speculative. So what the Buddha is saying, if you're a meditator, you should not be speculating on these things. That's not related to meditation. That's the meaning here. It's not that these things are bad. They are not connected with awakening. Right? Number five, the self is the same as the body, or the self and the body are different. They're all different views. In fact, we do not accept the idea of an unchanging self, so it's no problem at all. Then the last four, 7, 8, 9, 10, is the nature, the posthumous nature, or the post-mortem nature of the saint. What about the Buddha? Where is he now? Does he exist after death? Does he not exist after death? So here is where we have a problem of language. The suttas tell us, don't say the Buddha exists after death, that's wrong, because if you say that, then you have fallen into the wrong view of eternalism. Again, we can't say it does not exist, then we fall into the wrong view of annihilationism. Then what about both? Again, both are wrong, so you cannot put two wrongs together and make it right. And then the last one, neither exists nor not exists. That's called prevarication. In other words, you're not certain. Ill-wriggling. You're trying to, you know, twist your way around. It doesn't help. So the advice is, forget about all these things. It's purely speculative. It's not going to help. Nobody's going to agree with it all together. Everyone have their own views. their private truths. Each person has his own view, so it's better not to get into an argument with anyone regarding this, if you're a meditator or you're not a monk. All these he has put aside, pushed aside, given them up, discarded, abandoned, relinquished. In this way, because the monk, in other words, the arahat, is one who has put aside personal truths or private truths, pachika saccha. There's another term, a similar term. It's called view truth, ditti saccha. So, as long as we are unawakened, we are expressing view truth. That's our view, or I suppose, opinion, if you like. So in a sense, whatever we are learning here, whatever I'm telling you, are all provisional truth. I mean, they're not useless, but they're provisional. In other words, right now, this is the best we have. In a sense, I know I'm talking, and you probably understand what I'm saying too. And for the moment, you say, wow, this is great, I can understand this. But imagine, a few years ago, you've heard some talks before. And at that time, and you look back, you say, oh, my understanding was not very good at that time. Now when I look back, yeah, I've changed my mind here, I've changed my mind there. And then another 5 years ahead, you look back, you say, yeah, you're going to change your mind about what you heard today. Not that what you heard is wrong. It helps you to have a clearer picture in the future. That's the meaning. So our views must change and grow in that sense. And all teachings we understand are provisional. Okay, the teachings are not provisional, but our understanding of the teaching is provisional, you know what I mean. So if you allow that, then there is growth. People who say, oh, I understand this completely, they are missing something, because what they're saying is, that's it, I have nothing more to learn. Wow, then you're an arahat, you know, right? So that also calls for tolerance in a sense. We just tell ourselves, all right, for the time being, I understand this. And then you move on. As you go higher into your spiritual development, you begin to fine-tune what you know. Number six, totally given up seeking. And how big shows is among one who has completely given up seeking, searching, okay, the quest. Here big shows for the monk, seeking for sensual pleasures has been abandoned. Seeking for existence has been abandoned. Seeking of the holy life has been abandoned. Now remember, we're talking about the arahat here, okay? So the arahat has given up three kinds of quests. The quest for sensual pleasures, it doesn't look for sensual pleasures. The quest for existence, for rebirth, it doesn't do that. Nor the quest for the holy life, looking for the right teaching, so to speak, the right faith, or right religion, or whatever, right? So in this way, bhikshus, the monk is one who has completely given up seeking. He's enlightened, doesn't need any more seeking. Now you remember in the Arya Pariyesana Sutta, the discourse on the noble quest, the Buddha tells us about how he left home and tried to look for answers. So he says he realized there are two quests. The first quest, he says, what's the point of having worldly things which are subject to change, to destruction, to corruption? All these worldly things will be destroyed and they don't help us really. So the quest for worldly things is not helpful. It's called the anariya. Pariyasana or anariyasana. In other words, the ignoble quest, not helpful. Whereas the noble quest is the quest for something that is not impermanent, not changing, something satisfactory, something liberating. And that is the quest for nirvana. So he gives quite a long passage, differentiation between these two quests. But here, we're talking about the arahat, whose quest is over. He doesn't have to search for anymore. We are still searching for us, for things, for answers. We're not awakened. But in the case of the arahat, no more search. He has found the answers. He's very happy with it. And he's enjoying these moments of peace, if you like. Now, number seven, trouble-free mind. You can see from six, naturally it leads to seven. Once you have found the answer, you live a peaceful life. And how bhikshus is a monk, one with untroubling thoughts. Here, bhikshus, for the monk, has abandoned the thought of sensuality, has abandoned the thought of ill will, has abandoned the thought of cruelty. In this way, bhikshus, the monk is one with untroubling thoughts. So this is called right thought, right? A thought free from desiring this and that, free from the opposite, this hatred, ill will, and no thoughts of cruelty. So the monk basically is happy, at peace with himself. So this is where his mind is untroubled. In other words, whenever we are troubled, whenever we are not happy, whenever our mind is unsettled, there's something we desire, which we cannot get. There's something we're upset about. Or there's some thoughts of violence, cruelty, that makes us unhappy. If we are truly happy, we wouldn't hurt people, we wouldn't think of hurting, we wouldn't think of any negative thoughts. Now we're reaching more subtle levels now. Number eight, skilled bodily formation. And how bhikshus is among one who has skilled bodily activity, bodily formation or bodily activity. Here bhikshus among with the abandoning of joy and abandoning of pain, and with the earlier disappearance of pleasure and displeasure, attains and dwells in the fourth dhyana that is neither painful nor pleasant, and with mindfulness fully purified by equanimity. Bhikshu Satamang is one who has still the bodily formation. This is a reference to the fourth dhyana. Of course, you may question, why the first two dhyanas not mentioned? Well, they kind of understood in even the very first statement just now. So here, the teaching is regarding the whole body is at peace. Sometimes bodily formation or bodily activity refers to the breath. Okay? When is the breath really so calm you don't notice it anymore? Another way of questioning is, when does breathing actually stop? What is still alive? Okay? During the fourth jhana. So here, the arahat is able to do this. This refers to a teaching called cessation. Cessation. It's called nirodha. Nirodha. The full term is this one, Sanyana. This is a very deep form of meditation, Sanya, Veda, Yita, Nirodha. The cessation of perception and feeling. Sanya is perception, vidyata, what is felt. Only non-returners and arahats can attain this level. This is called the ninth stage in the nine progressive abodes, Anu, Buba, Vihara. The nine stages are the four form jhanas, the four formless jhanas, and you got to go through them one by one, like a eight-story building or nine-story building. You take a lift, got to go through all the floors in order to reach number nine. Okay, So number nine is cessation. Only the arahant or the non-returner can do this. In simple terms, in science fiction stories, we call this stasis. In other words, by all medical measurements, modern measurements, the person is dead. No breath, no mental activity, no heartbeat, nothing. No responses. The person can be in that state for at least 7 days. Some teachers say more. Okay? 7 days usually is the what we have in the suttas. So only the arahat and the non-returners can do this. So this passage refers to this ability. The breath also stops. Right? So here we're talking about the nature of the awakened person. Okay, so this is one of these lessons where we talk about something quite advanced in that sense, right? So these are the, what you call, the mind, the whole body completely still, the mind also still. Then comes the last two, 9 and 10, they go together. And how bhikshus is among mentally well liberated. Now look at number 10. And how bhikshus is among well liberated by wisdom. Very often in the suttas, when we describe the awakening of the arahat, he is often said to be mentally liberated and liberated, mentally freed, comma, freed by wisdom. Chetto vimutti, panya vimutti, right? Here, they are put together as the last two items. They are also the last two items in the 10 rightness, the samatha, okay? Now, you know the word samma, samma means right in the Eightfold Path. The abstract noun is samatha, rightness. Because the tenfold path. So you have the Eightfold Path, Sila, Samadhi, Panya, and then you have number 9 and 10 here. The mind of the meditator is well liberated. Okay, now let's read. What does it mean? Look at 12. Here, bhikshus, the monk's mind is liberated from greed. His mind is liberated from hatred. His mind is liberated from delusion. Liberated from greed, hate, delusion. Free from the three roots of karmic motivation. I realize that when you see the word liberated here, it means the mind is freed from the mental hindrances. The mind is totally free and ready. Ready for what? Ready to be used for the arousing of wisdom, which is what number 10 is. That's why I say they go together. See? Look at number 10. And how bhikshu is among well liberated by wisdom. Look at the wordings. Here bhikshu among understands thus, lust has been abandoned by me, cut down at the root, made like a palm tree stump. Palm tree stump, like a coconut tree. You know, once a coconut tree is cut at the base, it won't grow again. So the Indians know this very well. In Malaysia also, we know this very well. I've seen this stump quite often. In Singapore, we don't see this. Unless you go to Botanic Gardens, maybe. So look at this one, and look at the first parallel line, and the number 12. The monk's mind is liberated from greed. Here, lust has been abandoned. Greed and lust are the same thing here. But in number 13, section 13, the word is abandoned. That means no more, it's gone. Whereas liberated, it means temporarily free, you see? It may come back. In our case, if you stop at number 9, it will come back. But in the case of the arahat, number 12 refers to jhana, section 12. So he gets into that deep state, he comes out of it, and then he does his wisdom exercise. And lust hate delusion are uprooted totally, and that's called liberated by wisdom, liberation by wisdom. Okay, so these last two are the code for the Arahat formula. That means this person has become Arahat, mentally liberated, liberated by wisdom. The two aspects. If you like, you can say mentally liberated is samatha, liberated by wisdom is vipassana. Also can, right? Because the different emphasis here. So there you are. We have finished this. Then the Buddha closes with section 14. Bhikshus, whichsoever monks in the past who live in the noble abidings, they all live in these very same 10 noble abidings. Bhikshus, whichsoever monk in the future who live in the noble abidings, they will all live in this very same 10 noble abidings. Bhikshus, whichever monks in the past who are in the present, who are living in the noble abidings, they all are living in this very same 10 noble abidings. So here's an affirmation of the truth, eternal truth, past, present, future. This is a kind of passage which Pali teachers love to use to teach the students three periods of time, past, present, future, in terms of tenses, right? So, if someone asks you, which sutta can I read which describes the nature of the Arahant, this is the sutta. Okay? Now, I'm not saying it's something easy. It took me 40 years to understand. Okay, so here I am presenting it to you. Hope you get something from it. Let's close with a short reflection. Now, as the lunar year ends, this is the time for us to recollect how time passes, and also this new opportunity for us to aspire towards greater things, towards happier things. And as Buddhists, we always should ask ourselves, what should I do as a Buddhist? What is my goal in life? And the suttas remind us to reflect on impermanence and to aspire at least to attain stream winning, so that we are assured of stable happiness in our life, our lives to come. Reflecting in this way is good karma, but above such good karma, may we be blessed with the courage and wisdom to aspire to attain at least stream winning in this life itself. By the same token of goodness, by the power of the three jewels, that are sent out our loving kindness to all the people here, to all the beings in this temple, may they be well, may they be happy. May their minds always be happy with the Dharma. May those who work here, may those who come here find true happiness. And let us also send out our loving kindness to all our loved ones, those who have been kind and supportive of us. Those who are practicing the Dharma too, may they be well, may they be happy. Those who are seeking the Dharma and those who have difficulties finding the truth, may they too be happily liberated in this life itself. May all beings be well and happy. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.